Lord, I'm so thankful for all these beautiful people that are here Sunday morning and have put you first place in their life, God. And Lord, I'm going to share best I know how from the Bible. And I just ask, Holy Spirit, that you would come and you would speak and that it would be way more of you than me and that you'd hide me in the shadow of the cross so that King Jesus, you would be glorified.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay. How many people here read their Bible every single day this week? Every day. Wow. That's good, man. That's good. For everybody else, it's makeup time today. We're going to get you caught up on the Word. So let's get started. Let's go to Luke chapter 23. And I'm going to power through some of this stuff, and some of it I'm going to linger and share a bit. But I want to start in 23 because I'm going to talk about forgiveness. Forgiveness is something that I love to receive. I love it. Forgiveness. Woo! The part that I find challenging is forgiving other people. So we're going to talk a bit about that. All right, 23. James, we're going to read this very fast. Then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man to be subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Messiah, a king." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no basis for a charge against this man." But they insisted, "He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here." On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he had been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform a sign of some sort. Jesus is not a magician. Jesus is the Savior of the world. And the reason he does miracles and wonders is because he loves you. And he wants to show you that he loves you. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him, dressing him in an elegant robe. Jesus is familiar with all our different types of suffering that we encounter. So, Jesus knows what it's like to have his friends betray him. He knows what it's like to be mocked and made fun of. And this is the Savior of the world. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him, dressing him in an elegant robe. They sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people and said to them, "You brought this man as one who is inciting the people to rebellion. I have examined him in your presence and have found no basis for your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him." But the whole crowd shouted, "Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us." Now Barabbas was a murderer, bad dude. Barabbas had been thrown in. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again. But they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found him in no grounds for death penalty. Therefore I will leave him punished and then release him." But with loud shouts, they insistently demand him that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will. As the soldiers led him away, they seized Simon from Cyrene, who was on his way in from the country, and put the cross on him, and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large number of people followed him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. Jesus turned and said to them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children. For the time will come when you will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that never bore and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if people do these things when the tree is green, what will happen when it is dry?" Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right and the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." I can't imagine being in that place where you'd actually forgive someone who is trying to crucify you. And not just forgive them, but you're innocent. You're not even getting what you deserve. And you're asking God to forgive them. I don't know about you, but I sometimes want people to get what they deserve. Ever feel that way? I hope they get what they deserve. Get what's coming to them. What did Jesus say? Forgive them. And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him come and save himself, for he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence? We are punished justly, for we are getting what we deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you'll be with me in paradise." I love that. That guy on the cross beside Jesus did nothing to deserve the mercy and grace that Jesus offered, except for one thing. He recognized Jesus as the Savior. Do you see what he did? He said, "Hey, Jesus, remember me." That's all the bad stuff you did. Man, it doesn't matter. Why? Because he asked Jesus. I love that. Let's go now to Acts 7, chapter 51. Acts 7, chapter 51. I'm sorry, James. It's actually Acts 7, verse 51. I love hearing Bible pages, Casey. This is Stephen. So we've got these 12 disciples. And these 12 disciples are getting so busy because everybody's coming to them for stuff. And these disciples said, "We need help." So they picked 7 more guys. And one of the guys' names was Stephen, or Stephen. And what happened was, Stephen actually started doing miracles and preaching the gospel, just like some of the disciples were doing. And this was making a lot of the Pharisees and church people pretty angry and upset. And so they want to kill this guy, so they bring him before the Pharisees to pass judgment on him. And he says, hey, here's what happened about Jesus. But he also says, you guys, you're so caught up in your religion and trying to keep the law, which you can't even keep. And you're leading all these people astray away from God instead of towards God. Mm-hmm. And so here's where we see, you stiff-necked people, your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You are just like your ancestors. You always resist the
Holy Spirit.
Wow. Was there ever a prophet your ancestor did not persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one. And now you have betrayed and murdered him. You who have received the law that was given through angels, but have not obeyed it. When the members of the Sanhedrin, or the judges, heard this, they went crazy. They gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God. Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. At this they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him. Have you ever shared the good news of Jesus Christ with people? And they just get to the point where, I don't want to hear it anymore, man! Do you know why that's happening? It's because something in their heart is stirring that they don't want to acknowledge. And that's the same way with these guys. Something was stirring in their hearts that they didn't want to acknowledge. And they're going, oh, I can't take this anymore. They dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their coats at the feet. This is important. They laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. Now, Saul becomes Paul when he encounters Jesus on the road to Damascus. And that's significant because of what Stephen says next. See, because Saul here wanted to kill Christians because he thought he was doing a good thing. But he's under the same condemnation that everybody else is going to be under. Because he's just standing there watching, going, this is cool, man. Let's see this guy get what he deserves. So they throw their cloaks at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Do not hold this sin against them. Sounds a lot like Jesus to me. Do not hold. So what's happening right now, Stephen is being stoned. And he has every right to hope that something really awful happens to these people who are stoning him. Because he's innocent. But he says, no, forgive them, Father. Don't hold their sins against them. Now, do you know what happens to Paul on the road to Damascus? He meets Jesus. Paul ends up writing great books like Romans and Corinthians and Thessalonians, and three quarters of the New Testament Paul writes. But what would have happened to Paul if Stephen did not say, Lord, don't hold this sin against him. Do you see the freedom that happened for Paul? Because if that was never prayed, Paul would have been under condemnation like everybody else. Forgiveness, I can't. So I'll share a quick story before we go to Numbers 14. This past week, a family member of mine said, Mark, will you give me a ride on Thursday at 1 o'clock? He was very adamant. Give me a ride Thursday at 1 o'clock. And I said, sure, okay. And then he said, why don't we grab lunch first and then give me a ride at 1 o'clock? I'm like, sure, okay. So it's coming up to lunchtime, and I called this person, and I said, hey, I'm running about 20 minutes late. I'm working, but I'll come, we'll grab lunch, and then I'll drop you off at 1 o'clock. And this person was disappointed, but said, okay. Quick, take a shower, get out, ready to go. And I check my voicemail. And it is a nasty voicemail. And the voicemail says, hey, Mark, you know, you really disrespected me, late for lunch, stuff like that, blah, blah, blah. And that ride you wanted to give me, yeah, I wanted to give. That ride you wanted to give me, well, shove it up your... I'm like, whoa. So this really upsets me, right? Because it's a family member. And so I called them, knowing that I would get their voicemail. And I just said, hey, you know what? I'm really sorry. Please forgive me. Please forgive me. And that was hard to do because I was upset and hurt that I'm trying to help them and they're leaving me all this junk. Same with Jesus and Stephen. He's trying to help the people that are being nasty to them. So I'm going to go see this person this afternoon. So pray for me. Now you may think this is a New Testament thing. It's not a New Testament thing. It's an Old Testament thing too, because God never changes. Let's go to Numbers 14, verse 17. Tell me when James has it up. Okay. Now this is Moses talking to the people. So they've just come out of Egypt. And God did all these crazy miracles and stuff like that. And you know the first thing they do when they're out of Egypt and Moses leaves them for a couple weeks? Let's make a golden calf and let's worship it. God just did these 10 crazy miracles to get you out of Egypt. And Moses is gone for 2 weeks, and you start to say, hey, let's make a golden calf. That's how short our memory is when it comes to God and His goodness. So what happens? Moses starts to have a discussion with God. Moses is trying to talk God out of what God has planned for the people. Now may the Lord's strength be displayed, just as you have declared. The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love, and forgiving sin and rebellion. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children for the sin of the parents to the third and the fourth generation. According with your great love, forgive the sin of these people, just as you have pardoned them from the time they left Egypt until now. What was the Lord's answer? The Lord replied, I have forgiven them just as you asked. Wow. So that was in the Old Testament already. So here are Jesus and Stephen repeating what was already God's will and God's nature about forgiveness. All right, let's go to Matthew 18:21. Is James there? Another disciple said to him, Lord,
what?
Verse 21, then Peter came to Jesus. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Okay, everybody stand up for a minute. Everybody stand up for a minute. We've got 15 more minutes. So I want you to wave your hand at me and say, I'm wide awake.
I'm wide awake.
I'm ready to receive from the Lord.
I'm ready to receive from the Lord.
All right, have a seat. I saw some heavy eyelids.
I would have made some jumping jacks.
All right, then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or my sister who sins against me? Famous scripture. If I'm really good, Jesus, how about seven times? How about seven times I forget that jerk that left me that voicemail? Seven times. How about that, Jesus? He's thinking that's pretty generous. Jesus is going to like me for this answer. Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times seven. Now, who is ready to do that?
Me.
Ever been ripped off by somebody?
Yep.
Want to be ripped off again by the same person? How about seven times ripped off by that person? No! God doesn't ask you to be a doormat. If somebody's hurting you, you need to give some distance to that person. God still asks you to forgive them. There's a difference here. God doesn't want you to be in a doormat and be in an abusive situation. God still wants you to forgive. 77 times 7. So that's one application of offering forgiveness. Now, some of us who are Christians, and we've been Christians for a while, we've screwed up. And ever been, God, here I am again with the same issue that I asked you for forgiveness for last week and yesterday and again today. I've been there. And you don't have to put your hand up, but maybe you've been there. But this is an excellent example of God's great love for you. Because you think you can't do it. You think you can't be good enough. You think you can't stay away from your repetitive sin that you keep doing over and over again. Well, I've got good news for you. If Jesus asked you to forgive 77 times 7, good chances he's going to forgive you 77 times 7. He doesn't ask you to do anything that he's not willing to do. So I don't care how many times you sin, every time you go to him, he extends his forgiveness. Now, I feel awful after I sin. And that's what's called sting. You get a bee sting, ow. It doesn't go away right away. It kind of lingers a bit. And that's so you know that bees sting and it hurts. Stay away from bees. And that's what God's trying to say. When we feel that sting of sin, God's trying to say, sin is not healthy for you. I am healthy for you. Let's keep reading. Verse 23, therefore the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold, that's a lot of money, was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children be sold into hard labor to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees and said, please, be patient with me, he begged, and I'll pay everything back. The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. So it didn't say took pity on him and gave him terms and reduced the interest payment.
Yeah.
No, it said took pity on him and canceled the debt and let him go. But then that same servant found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed that guy and began to choke him and said, pay back what you owe me. The servant fell to his knees, just like the other guy did, and said, be patient with me, I'll pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison. When the other servant saw what happened, They went to their master and told him everything. Then the master called back this servant and said, "Hey, you wicked servant, I canceled your debt because you begged me. Shouldn't you have mercy on your fellow servant just like I had on you?" And that's what I'm reminded of. Whenever I'm in with somebody, I remember what Jesus did for me. And when I remember what Jesus did for me, I all of a sudden view people in a lot better light than what I used to view them in. Let's go to Mark 11. Mark 11. Verse 22. Jesus had just performed a miracle with a fig tree. We read, "Have faith in God," Jesus answered. "Truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, 'Go throw yourself into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what they say will happen, it will be done for them. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you receive it, and it will be yours. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive your sins." So two things here. One, we have a great big God. And we shouldn't be afraid to believe him for great big things. Whether it's relationship, whether it's finances, whatever it is. God loves you and he's a big God. But as a reminder, when we're asking for stuff for ourselves, God says, "By the way, do you need to forgive anybody?"
Oh. Well, as a matter of fact, that guy that cut me off, I cussed him up pretty good, God. I've done that. Come on. I'm a born-again, spirit-filled Christian, but sometimes when somebody cuts me off in my car, I go, "Oh, grumble, mumble, bumble, crumple." And then I say, "Oh, bless him, Lord." I do, because then the Holy Spirit comes in and says, "Hey, Buster." He calls me Buster sometimes. Let's go to Luke 15. We're almost done. Pastor Pickett, if you're watching, we love you.
Yes,
we miss
you.
Doing my best here.
We got this.
Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. Who's gathering around Jesus?
Tax collectors.
And who else?
Sinners.
Who?
Sinners.
Sinners. What's God want us to do? He wants us to hang out and tell the good news to others. People who are maybe outside our comfort zone. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners." Oh, that's good news. This man welcomes sinners. Woo! It makes me happy. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? Ever done that? Where's that? Where's that? Oh my gosh, where did I put that? Where's that money? And you're going crazy trying to find it. And I encourage you, if you lose anything, ask God to show you where it is.
Yes.
Because he's done that to me so many times I thought I lost something. So let's keep going. And when she finds it, She calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents.
Amen.
That's good news. So if you think you've missed it, and you've screwed up, and you come to Jesus, and you say, "Hey, Jesus, I missed it yesterday. Remember that thing I did? Well, I know you know about it, but I just want to tell you that I'm sorry, and I'd really like your help so I don't do that again." There's a bunch of angels rejoicing in heaven. Woo! He's going to try again this week. That's good news. That's the forgiveness that God offers us. 77 times 7. Amen? Let's stand up and pray. We've got some ministry folks who will be up here at the front in just a minute, and they would love to pray for you if you need prayer, if you're struggling with something. Oh Lord, God Almighty, thank you for forgiveness. Lord, help us to forgive others when they sin against us, Lord. As we saw by the example that you gave us, that Stephen gave us, Lord, to forgive others. Help us, Lord. Soften our hearts, Lord. And so, Lord, we just want to tell you again, we're so thankful for what you did on the cross, Jesus, for setting us free from darkness into your marvelous light. And Lord, if there's anyone here who hasn't accepted you as their Lord and their Savior, Lord, I pray that they would take some time this morning to do that, to say, "Jesus, come into my heart and change me. Forgive me from my sins. Begin afresh in me." Amen. Amen.